Today, we're going to continue on with the sermon series in Luke, the story of Jesus. And so we're looking at Luke chapter 14, and I was talking about the dust. If you happen to pull a Bible out from underneath, you'll notice some, if you didn't bring your Bible, you'll notice that there are some of them that are a little dusty, and one of them maybe wrote high on because we didn't get a chance to get those all cleaned. But so if you want to come in and dust the Bibles, it would be a great object lesson about, you know, dusty Bibles, how many people have Bibles that sit on their shelves that collect dust. But I would rather the Bibles get used here at the church. So even if you want to pull it out and just kind of dust it on your pants or something, you know, it's all good. Don't dust them on the chairs. They're clean. But just another thing to volunteer, that would be awesome. But open them to Luke chapter 14, beginning with verse 25. It was back in 1984, February 2nd, 1984, at the presidential prayer breakfast, or national prayer breakfast, that President Ronald Reagan told this story about Telemachus, a monk that lived in the 5th century around 400 AD, 400 somewhere in there. And Telemachus, it's a story I have shared numerous different times. Hey, how's it going? It's really hard when the chairs are like this and you're right here. Telemachus was a monk. She's going to kill me later, aren't you? Was a monk. And he was a follower of Jesus Christ. And he did not live in Rome. But this monk was credited with ending the gladiators and people fighting for the entertainment of spectators to kill themselves. And Telemachus was out, and he was working, and God spoke to him, and he began to sense in this God speaking to him moment that he wanted him to go to Rome. So Telemachus headed off to Rome, and he wasn't sure what he was supposed to do in Rome, why he was going to Rome, but he headed off to Rome, and as he's traveling to Rome, he arrives in Rome, and there's these crowds of people that are coming to Rome as well, and so he just starts following the crowd, and they are going to the Colosseum, where there's going to be a big show that day of gladiators fighting to the death. And the gladiators would say, "We who are about to die salute you," as they would look up to the emperor, and they knew they were going to die. And as Telemachus was there, depending on the story that you read, he became very agitated and irritated. He knew why God had called him there, because what was taking place of people fighting and killing each other for the entertainment of spectators was not right. It was wrong. And so Telemachus, he comes down out of the stage, and he gets between the two people that are the two gladiators that are fighting, and he tells them to stop in the name of Jesus, that it's not right. And there's a couple different ways the story goes, but no matter what exactly happened, whether he was stoned or whether he got jabbed with a spear and died, he died that day. And because of Telemachus being willing to take a stand for Jesus Christ and being willing to say stop in the name of Jesus Christ, that day was the last time where humans killed each other for entertainment in the Colosseums as a spectator sport. All because Telemachus was willing to take a stand. We have a purpose in this life, and we need to count the cost. Telemachus was one that had counted the cost, and he knew what was going to take place. And he was willing to give his life. Here at the church, we have a purpose statement that is based on Matthew chapter 28, the Great Commission, and Matthew chapter 22, the Great Commandment. And there are some words that are in bold that deal with evangelism and fellowship and discipleship and worship. And the purpose statement is rather lengthy, and most people have a hard time memorizing it. It's PFWSC exists to reach unbelievers, unite them with other Christians, help them grow in their faith, discover their gifts, and see them become radically committed to Jesus Christ, both in life and in death. That is really long. And a lot of people have not ever heard it, nor have they memorized it, but that's our purpose statement for the church. And it's one that we have put together about 15, 16 years ago, and we have pretty much stood by it. That rather than a longer version like this, we also have a shorter version, which is much easier for people to be able to remember. And it is relentlessly pursuing Jesus Christ and the people that he loves. Relentlessly, relentlessly pursuing Jesus Christ and the people he loves. Not holding back. We're going to pursue him no matter what. Relentlessly. Come hell or high water, I'm going to pursue Jesus Christ. I'm not going to let the distractions of this world, the distractions physically, whatever, stop me. I'm going to pursue Jesus Christ. Relentlessly pursuing Jesus Christ and the people that he loves. Would you repeat that with me this morning? Relentlessly pursuing Jesus Christ and the people he loves. One more time. Relentlessly pursuing Jesus Christ and the people he loves. As a disciple of Jesus Christ, we are to count the cost and we are to relentlessly pursue Jesus Christ and the people that he loves. In Luke chapter 14, beginning with verse 25, it talks about a large crowd of people following Jesus. People came. Why did people come to follow Jesus? Because of what they could get from him. They could get healing from him. They heard incredible teaching from him. They got food from him. I mean, he was like, you know, they didn't have to do anything. They were like, he was like the government. He could take care of them all. Oh, wait, the government can't take care of everybody. The church is called to do in conjunction with the government, work together to try to make a difference, and then individuals will rise up. But people sat back and they just came because they wanted to get what they could get for free. What they could get for free. He turned around and he said to them, if you want to be my disciple, if you really want to be my follower, you must, by comparison, hate everyone else, your father, mother, wife, children, brothers, sisters, yes, even your own life. Verse 28, but don't begin until you count the cost. For who would begin construction of a building without first calculating the cost to see if there is enough money to finish it? Otherwise, you might complete only the foundation before running out of money, and then everyone would laugh at you. They would say, there is the person who started that building and couldn't afford to finish it. Verse 31, or what king would go to war against another king without first sitting down with his counselors to discuss whether his army of 10,000 could defeat the 20,000 soldiers marching against him? And if he can't, he will send a delegation to discuss terms of peace while the enemy is still far away. So, you cannot be my disciple without giving up everything you own. Jesus wants us to count the cost before we follow him. He wanted his disciples to count the cost. He wants each of us to count the cost. Billy Graham said, salvation is free. There we go. Salvation is free, but discipleship cost everything. Salvation is free, but discipleship cost everything. Many Christians accept God's free gift of salvation, but are not willing to live for God. It sounds kind of like a contradiction to me. It sounds like the game of Monopoly. They want the get out of jail free card, but they don't want to have to do anything. They want the get out of hell free card, but they don't want to follow Jesus Christ relentlessly and the people that he loves. In fact, I believe it's one of the biggest problems facing the church in America today. We're lukewarm. We're weak. Or as my brother Mark would say, we're pansy Christians. He and my brother Mark was in Australia. I'm probably going to get in trouble. This is videotaped. And pansy has a different definition in Australia. And he stood up and said, God doesn't like any pansy Christians. And you can ask me later what the word pansy means, but everybody was in shock when he said that, and they're like, The Bible is very clear in Revelation that if we're lukewarm, he's going to spew us out of his mouth. God wants us to be relentlessly pursuing him and the people that he loves. He wants us to be committed. There are three things that I believe that's going to cost you to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Number one, it's going to cost you your favorite sins. It's going to cost you your favorite sins. There are things that hold us back, sins that hold us back. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, it says, Therefore, since you are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, others who are watching us, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Sin entangles us. It trips us up, causing us to stumble and to fall. I have really enjoyed working out at our property with clearing out along our creek and clearing out by the woods, but I found that there are a lot of vines, especially on the edge of the woods and along the creek. And there have been numerous times as I've been cleaning out along there that I have tripped up, and I'll be having my weed trimmer going, and next thing you know, I'm tripping forward. And there's been a couple times that I've fallen down on my face with the weed trimmer, putting it out, trying to save it, especially in the creek, by when I'm by the creek, not wanting to get it all wet and messed up. And that's exactly what sin does. It messes us up and gets us sidetracked so we're not focusing our attention on Jesus Christ being the men and women, the students that are men and women, that he has called us to be. And so we've got to give up our favorite sins. Too often we tolerate sin in our lives. We call them little sins, trying to justify them. And even those little sins that we try to justify are still sins that will trip us up. And it doesn't take long for those little sins to destroy us and become big sins. So we have to be on guard. Psalms 19:13 says, Keep your servant from deliberate sins. Don't let them control me. Then I will be free of guilt and innocent of great sin. Sin trips us up, and too often we tolerate that sin. And as we tolerate that sin, it ends up holding us in bondage. When we sin against God, we are in essence saying that my way is better than your way. When we sin against God and we hold on to that sin that's holding us in bondage, we are basically saying, my way is better than your way, God. I'm right, you're wrong. Ouch. God wants the best for us. And so he wants us to submit to him. Not because he is some dictator that wants to tell us every little thing to do, but because he has planned something really awesome for us. He knows us better than we know ourselves. And so what he has in store for us may seem odd to us at the moment, and like it's going not the direction we should want to go, but yet God has something greater in store. He knows us better than we know ourselves, and he knows the rewards that are going to be in store if we are obedient to him. And as we are obedient to him, the reason he wants us to be obedient to him isn't to be some cosmic dictator. It's so that we can be free. We can be free. Galatians 5:1 says, So Christ has truly set us free. John 8:31 and 32, Jesus again reiterates that, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Let me ask you a question this morning. What secret sins are there in your life that you're keeping from others that are tripping you up? Or maybe you don't think they're tripping you up, but they are. God knows what those sins are. Psalms 90 verse 8 says, You have set our iniquities before you, the bad things, our secret sins in the light of your presence. He knows what we do even when we do it in secret. following Jesus demands that we will deal with our favorite sins and our secret sins. And as a disciple of Jesus Christ, if we are going to relentlessly pursue him and the people he loves, it's going to cost us our favorite sins. And we need to let him go in Jesus' name. We need to let him go. Number two, not only will following Jesus Christ relentlessly being a disciple of him cost you your favorite sin, but it's also going to cost you favor with the world. Favor with the world. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 and 16 says, "Do not love the world, nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you." Did you catch that? We frequently want the world's approval and applause. We want what the world has. We're longing and desiring the things of the world. We can say we don't, but come on, if you're honest, there are a lot of things that we have. And Jesus says, don't love the world nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasures, a craving for everything we see, and the pride in our achievements and possessions. These are not from God the Father, but are from this world. These are not from God the Father, but from the world. And then James 4:4 says, "Don't you realize that friendship with the world makes you an enemy with God?" I say it again. If you want to be friends of the world, you make yourself an enemy to God. Whew. That steps on some toes. Amen? Oh, come on. You know it steps on toes. If it steps on my toes, it's stepping on your toes. Too many people look to the things of this world for contentment. Too many people look to the things of this world for contentment. Have you ever purchased something that you knew you needed to have? I want it, I gotta have it, I just need to have it. And then once you purchase it, a month or so into it, pretty soon you may like what you have, but you're starting to regret the decision because you're in debt for the next 50 years. It's controlling you. You don't get the joy that you had when you first got it. But you had to have it. You had to pursue it. The world can never satisfy our deepest needs, only God. The world can never satisfy our deepest needs, only God. Can you repeat that with me this morning? The world can never satisfy our deepest needs, only God. The world can't do it. The world can't. Only God can satisfy your deepest needs. And we look to the world to satisfy our wants and our desires. People won't satisfy you. Things won't satisfy you. Only God can satisfy you. Jesus asked this question, "What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world, yet loses his own soul?" What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world, yet loses his own soul? He pursues all the things of this world. I've used the illustration. I watched the life history of Elvis Presley. And at the very end of Elvis Presley's life, he had it all. He had the cars, he had the girls, he had wealth, he had everything. And at the very end of the show about Elvis Presley's life history, he commits suicide, and the song that they're playing is, "I Did It My Way." He did it his way. God wants us to do it his way, not our way, not the world's way. He wants us to relentlessly pursue him and the people he loves. John chapter 15, verse 19 and 20 says, "If you belong to the world, it will love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember the words I spoke to you. No servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obey my teaching, they will obey you also. J.C. Ryer, a quote that I found, he wrote about the surrendered Christian, he must be content to be ill thought of by man if he pleases God. He must be content to be ill thought of by man if he pleases God. I tell you, the world is not going to love you. God loves you. The world will use you. So if we want to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, we're going to have to say no to sin. We'll have to say no, or we'll have to realize that it's going to cost us favor with the world. And number three, following Christ will cost us first place in our lives. Too often we put all sorts of things first in our lives. We put our spouses, we put our desires for someone. You know, when we're single, there's this mentality sometimes that I've got to have somebody, and if I don't have them, I'm not a complete person. Who you have to have is Jesus Christ. You may be married, but that person doesn't complete you. They complement you. Only God can complete you. And the longer you're married, as you put Christ in the center of your lives, the more it will seem as though they complete you because of how well they complement you and how much God is working you. But people seem to seek after. They have this gotta have a woman, gotta have a man syndrome. And a person will not complete you. That's why there's Mingle and FarmersOnly.com and you name it that are out there. They're all over because people have this gotta have a syndrome. And what we gotta have is a relationship with Jesus Christ, where we're relentlessly pursuing Him and the people He loves. People also try to fill up their hearts with putting their families first, putting their jobs first, putting sports and even politics first. But God never wants to have second place in our lives. God never wants to have second place in our hearts, church. He wants to be first. If we're going to be the church that He has called us to be, we've got to count the cost and we've got to relentlessly pursue Jesus Christ and the people He loves. God never wants second place in your heart. Can we repeat that together? God never wants second place in your heart. Actually, we should change that to my. God never wants second place in my heart. He does not. He wants first. In Luke chapter 14, verse 26, in the Contemporary English Version, we read this verse a little earlier, it says, "You cannot be my disciple unless you love me more than you love your father, your mother, your wife, your children, your brothers and sisters. You cannot come to me unless you love me more than you love your own life." You know, it is biblical to obey our parents. No matter how young or old we are, it is biblical to obey our parents. And all the young people said amen, right? I didn't hear. All the parents did. Yeah. The reason God wants us to obey Him and to love Him more is because He is the only one that knows what's best for us 100% of the time. He knows what's best for us 100% of the time. In the Message version of paraphrase, Luke chapter 14, verse 33, it says, "Simply put, if you're not willing to take what is dearest to you, whether plans or people, and kiss it goodbye, you can't be my disciple." It's so easy to put people and things above God. People, things, being possessions, power, whatever, it's so easy to put them above God. One of the hardest prayers to pray is the prayer that Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane when He said, "Not my will, but yours be done." Not my will, but yours be done. Our will wants all of this. We watch all the HDTV and all the lives of the rich and famous and all that stuff, and we want what they have. And God says, "I have what you need right here, right here. And so we have to say, not my will, yours be done. Because he has called us, Jesus has called us to follow his example. And then the Apostle Paul said, follow my example as I follow Jesus Christ. Jesus' example. That was a bold statement by Paul to be able to say, follow my example as I follow Jesus Christ. How many of us in here this morning, you don't have to raise your hand, but think about it for a moment. How many of you can say, follow my example as I follow Jesus Christ? Don't raise your hand. Think. How many of us can do that? Not my will. Yours be done. We pray it when we pray the Lord's Prayer. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And in order for his will to be done on earth, it has to start with us saying, not my will, yours be done. Following Jesus will cost you. It's going to cost you your favorite sins. It's going to cost you the favor with the world. And it's going to cost you first place in your heart. Because all the things that you've wanted to put there, you need to push aside and say, God, you're first place. Will you choose to not just believe in Jesus Christ, but to relentlessly pursue him and the people he loves? Will you choose to not just believe in Jesus Christ, but to relentlessly pursue him and the people he loves? This morning, I believe there are many here that have a favorite sin. They're seeking favor with the world, and you're putting something else before God. If you're honest, every single one of you and me, us, will say, yeah, there's some areas in my life I need to work on. And as we prepare to receive communion today, I'd like for us to bow our heads and take some moment just to be quiet and ask God to examine our hearts. What are we putting first in our lives? What are we putting first? How are we striving to gain favor with the world? Or what are our favorite sins? What is stopping you from relentlessly pursuing Jesus Christ and the people he loves? Father, this morning, I pray that you will speak to us and indeed help us to pursue you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, to love you above everything else. You have instructed us that we are to examine ourselves before communion and to confess our sins. So right here, right now, we confess. Because anything we place before you becomes a god, and that becomes a sin. That secret sin that we've been hiding from everybody else, God has called us to surrender it to him and to put him first. The approval of others that you have been seeking, God says, seek my approval. Relentlessly pursue Jesus Christ and the people he loves. Father, thank you for your forgiveness this day. thank you for your son's sacrifice for us. And as we partake of communion this morning, thank you for that great sacrament, that great reminder of your love for us. In Jesus' name.